brain's willingness to stop at anything to the point where it can be considered absurd. Breakfasts of Australia is just one example of this, and even so, I feel that today my discussion has barely made it past the project's first conclusion. Thank you.
Lecture-Recital today by Dr. Joyce Chen. Joyce Chen is Assistant Professor of Historical Keyboards here at University of Oregon. She is a native of Taiwan and is currently a PhD candidate in the Department of Music, Historical Musicology, and the Interdisciplinary Doctoral Program in Humanities at Princeton University. Under the guidance of Wendy Heller, Dr. Chen is currently working on her dissertation, Musica Experientia Experimentum, Acoustics and Artisanal Knowledge in the Global 17th Century, which explores the intersection between science, music, and aesthetics involving instrument making, sensory experience, and the development of acoustical theory. Dr. Chen holds a Doctor of Musical Arts in Harpsichord Performance from Stony Brook University and a Bachelor of Science in Mechanical Engineering from UC Berkeley. She has been on faculty at St. Joseph's University, the University of Delaware, and Delaware State University, where she also introduced a pilot program of HBCU Early Music Access Project in collaboration with Early Music America and the Princeton Grad Futures Program. Her lecture recital today is titled Cherche la Femme, Keyboard Music by Baroque Women Composers. Please help me welcome Dr. Joyce Chen.
You all hear me well? Yeah, I can hear myself very well. So just a note, I am still recovering from illness, some of you might know, and I'm doing my best here. I'm advancing my health from the next few days. So if I'm at some point have a little brain fog, just know this is what's happening and I'll quickly come back to it. So I just must say, when I proposed this lecture recital, I was very ambitious. I thought I can, you know, like, there are only a few that, you know, keyboard works by Baroque women composers, I think I can cover them all. And then I realized once I started researching, there's a lot. So, which is a good problem to have. So we will today actually just talk about five different composers, and I will play, actually will be a lot of playing, about 20 minutes of music. Instead of doing this all at once at the end, I think I will just talk about the composer, talk about the pieces, and also just give you kind of like what's really interesting about your compositions. I just want to ask around, when you saw this program, who do you think about, like, as, you know, Baroque female composer that came to your mind? Yes.
For keyboard music, I thought of the
Yes, definitely on the menu. What else? No. No. Yes.
I don't know. I mean, keyboardists. I'm not sure. I think of Isabella Andreini, or I think of it's a performer, Mario Strozzi, and various people.
Yes.
So keyboardists.
Keyboardists. That is actually a really tough one because I'm a keyboard player. I'm actually mostly a 17th century scholar, and a lot of the composers like Strozzi, I'm actually contributing a chapter for an edited volume, and we actually, she wrote a lot of vocal music, but we don't actually have keyboard music that was written by her. So I'm going to go to my first slide. So these are just a sample of all the different composers that, you know, it's very ambitious to put all the music in, but it will be here until next year if I were to play everything. So I have a little gift for everyone. I didn't make enough copies, so you might want to just share. So this is for you to take away if you want to. I compiled just all the different, all these different composers. Probably by date, I didn't really put them in the right order, but just a few different pieces they have. You know, John and Delia, we're going to look at first, and we've got Anna Bond, we've got Elizabeth Turner. Ignore my little joke, they're not from the Pirates of the Caribbean. That's not supposed to be on there, I just forgot to take you off on the printout. And then, like, you got all these different pieces. I actually did play through almost all of them. They're really interesting, very fun. Highly recommend if you're a people player, if you know someone else, give this list to them. And just, this is something to consider when you're programming your next recital, or if you're, you know, putting a concert proposal. That's something we should look at. All right, so I'm going to actually just dive right in, because we know we don't have that many. We have 45 minutes. All right, so the first one, Elizabeth Jacquet de la Guerre, French composer, 1665 to 1729. And this is, she's become kind of like a staple in really the keyboard, all the harp support is our kind of like repertoire. Like, since I was a student 15 years ago, this is someone that we play, and she really, her collection, she's got two different volumes. It's actually on your list too. One from 1687, is it? 87 and then 1707. And the two volumes are slightly different. The first volume is very interesting, which I'm going to play, has her very signature unmeasured prelude. And unmeasured prelude is actually quite, just literally, it's unmeasured. You will see in just a second. And she is, you know, the reason she has all these different unmeasured preludes because she's also very known for being a very good improviser. And she was a child prodigy and also became a favorite at Louis XIV court. And she was known to be a singer, violinist, and she can also play keyboard. She has most of her works that survive have been mostly chamber works, solo works, one opera, following the Louis tradition. And she continued her career after marriage, and she gave concerts and lessons at home. And we have a couple quotes about her, just like, she sings outside the most difficult music, she's a very great sight reader, she can accompany herself, and then like, play at the harp support at the same time, and she's got amazing facility, dexterity are great, and you will soon see what I mean by that. Some of the runs in her preludes are actually quite brilliant, can be technically challenging as well, and she will just improvise in one key area and moves into another. And so moving on to the unmeasured prelude. So this is not just, you know, if we're isolating, you know, this is just keyboard music at this time. This is a staple. We probably, some of us learning music history, is parsimony music is really influenced by lute playing, by guitar. So what we do is we actually play the chords rather than, you know, the block chords that you would hear on the piano. We actually break them apart. But then this prelude here is very much written in that tradition. So you can see all these chords, by the way, this is not a treble clef, so this is just for reference, forget what you're saying here. But you can see here are chords, and you get a bunch of black notes. By this time, late 17th century, she kind of is helping out the player a little bit. So when you have all the white notes, that means harmonic notes, meaning they're chords. They're more like the pillars of the pieces. And you have all these different black notes as, you know, transition notes or melodic notes. I'm talking too much. I'm going to play you just a little bit, and then we'll break it down a little bit more. So this is how this probably sounds like. What we expect to see at this time, in her suites, in the first volume, five different preludes, and I'm going to play just the prelude itself. You don't have to worry about following because I didn't put all the music up here, but it goes into a measured section. So we have the unmeasured section, which is very free. I'm going to play slightly different again. The whole thing, and we move into a measure section. Usually it can be a jig, can be some kind of dance. And then at the end, you go back into a measure section again. And if anyone is interested, I'm giving a recital next Tuesday. I'm giving another a measure prelude by Lecture-Recital. So you will hear the earlier a measure prelude versus the later one. So now just the prelude by Lecture-Recital.
Thank you.
encourage you to look into it, even if you're not a keyboard player, because every single harpsichord that plays it differently. So about 20 years after the first volume, after she's experimenting all these different kinds of, you know, different measured prelude, different allemande, all the dance forms, this is kind of the opening of the second volume. And what we see here, or what she did, is actually she started experimenting more with ornamentation. And just to give a little bit of context at this time, the French and the Italian were kind of competing for who's best at musical styles. So they actually were kind of fusing some of the, there are definitely a lot of Italian influences in the French composition. So what she did here, she put in a lot of, you know, ornamentations on the second page. So this is the first one. This is actually exactly the same piece. I'm going to play this, just this first page. And she actually written out a duple, means kind of the ornamented version, and she's telling us this is how she will actually ornament. And what's interesting about the second volume here, she's saying this volume can be played by the violin as well. So this is actually telling us a little bit of, you know, Jacques de la Guerre, her influences as an instrumentalist, you know, like how she's bringing the other idioms into harpsichord playing. So it's not just, her inspiration comes from, you know, vocal, comes from the lute tradition, but also violin in this case. So I'll just play first half original and then second half. Can someone actually click for me here, or that's okay. You know what? I'm just gonna come up very quick, very fast. So you'll see. First half. Give me 1 second. There you go. So this is actually an allemande, so a 4-4 dance, and this is not really dance anymore at this time, but they use it. Actually, French or any Baroque composer at this time would use the dance form as a medium. To write. Okay.
Thank you.
to 18th century. So the next composer I'm going to talk about is Elizabeth Turner, not from the movie, by the way. So she was mostly known as a performer, a soprano actually, but then she actually published a substantial amount of just musical works. And she's got more than 400 names appear on her subscriptions at this time. So you can actually, publish music, and you have, subscribers getting these music. So from her collection, we've seen big names like Handel, William Boyce, and John Stanley, all these English composers who are actually getting musical inspiration from her. And I was at the other panel yesterday with historical women. So just rethink about how, this kind of musical exchange, women are actually taking part, participating as an equal force in shaping how music sounded like or the aesthetics of this time. And Elizabeth Turner, we don't know very much just in terms of biography. There's one really big article about her, and that's about it, and then a few other. I would emphasize on just her, keyboard works. So she's got four harpsichord pieces and six lesson for harpsichord. She died in 1756. We don't really have other, when she was born. We do know that she was very, well regarded and praised as a performer, and she was dubbed the genius Miss Lisa Turner. I do want to turn your attention. I'm going to play this just a prelude from her first lesson in G. This is a time where Baroque is kind of going to a little bit gallant. It's where things get a little bit messy. We can't really quite categorize, but you do see that she's taken all these inspirations from different times. And this first piece I'm going to play, the prelude I'm going to play from her first lesson, you definitely see this kind of dramatic kind of element in her music. And she starts out with this really fiery scalar kind of, a fire light comes into it, and then she kind of like subdues with a more lyrical section. And then the second element we see here is this like interplay between the right hand and left hand, this kind of like conversation between the two voices. And then we go into the third element I see is, we see a lot of like Alberti bass at this time, which is like more like classical EDM. And then we go into this a pedal point again. So these are the three different elements I see in this prelude. And I'm going to play this now.
amassing this collection already. The next is like just a lot more scared. So and check it out. Like it's online. You can also find the library. The next person. Sorry, we're moving. This is the third composer, Elisabetta de Domberini. You might think she's Italian or some other from other places, but she's actually born in London from a noble family, and she actually established herself as a singer first and perform, you know, in one of the oratorio by Handel when she was just 16 years old in 1746. And she's got so much support and actually recognition. By the time she was 18, she was already performing her own concerts. And also, you know, performing her own original works, her own composition. And because she's a singer, especially, so she's got a lot of love songs in both Italian and English. And she was also one of the first women in Britain to compose a collection of Hebrew music at this time. Categorized, she's mostly late Baroque, Milan style, things. Oh yeah, and she was actually performing at Haymarket Theater at this time, and you can see her style. If you don't know this by Domberini, if you're listening to her pieces on the radio, like I did, I thought it was by J.C. Bach, one of Bach's son, the London Bach. Like the style is very similar, and Handel, late Handel, and Haydn. And possibly because, as you can see from her date, she died at 35. We're kind of speculating it was from childbirth at this time, so she was not as not as well known compared to some of the other female composers at this time, just due to the fact that she died very young. And this is why. But she was very prolific. Six sets of lessons for the harpsichord, and she got the lessons for the harpsichord intermixed with Italian and English songs. So I have about, let me see, you got time. So I'm going to play just a little bit of actually her minuet that she composed. It's very charming. It's very different from the Turner that used her, very different from Jacques de la Guerre. This is very much, you know, you hear the two-part voice, and usually the melody line is very singable. It can easily be played by, you know, a flute, or it can easily be played by violin as well. So this is a minuet with three variations. And this is from the Lessons for the Harpsichord intermixed with the songs, that collection from 1748. When she was just 18 years old. Great.
Thank you.
charming, super cute, is, as you heard, is a minuet with a few variations from this collection, with harpsichord works and also Italian and English songs. The next piece I will actually play is from this actually song, little song arrangement she composed. And here's the lyrics. Lover, go and calm thy sighs. Night shall hide thee from all eyes. The god of love shall be thy guide. Be faithful and in him confide. So this is the little love song that she wrote. After the love song, she wrote a whole keyboard variation. So this is the next thing I'm going to play. And I am only, yeah, I'm only leaving off this slide. She actually studied at the Ospedale della Piatta, but she was not an orphan. She actually was there enrolled as a tuition paying student. So she was still studying music and, you know, singing the choir with all the other students. And she came from a very, you know, musical family. Most of them, most of these female composers actually, they all come from a musical family. But especially Anna Bon, you know, her father was a librettist and her mother was a singer. Definitely helps. And you can see her, all her works are really well-rounded. I actually first encountered her work as for flute sonatas with harpsichord. And later on, I discovered she's also written a lot of harpsichord works, as you can see here. What is interesting, though, different from Gamberini, what we heard was very much vocal inspired at this time, and these compositions are around the same time. I think the one I just played was 1756, and for this harpsichord sonata I'm about to play, I'm actually going to compare two for you, just to showcase her strength in creating contrasting characteristics in the pieces. This is just 1 year after the piece I played. Different composer, excuse me. But what she did was, it's almost like a little, if I didn't know, I thought this is a piece maybe by C.P. Bach, because a lot of time her pieces are really instrumental inspired. This is definitely not singable, and this is almost like a Bach prelude opening that you can easily hear from the organ. So this is the sonata number 4 in C major. I just thought it would be nice to compare another one in C major. Sorry. Ooh, where did it go? Oh, this one is also C major, but I only give you what is interesting here. Anyone notice these little squiggle? What are they? You probably know what it is. Ornaments. Yes. So this is actually played really quickly. So you will see how I'm actually putting the ornaments in just a little bit. But I want to just, this is the second piece I'm going to play. But just to show you, her pieces, even though she was a singer as well, her pieces are not quite as singable, not as lyrical compared to numbering that I just played. So this is the first C major allegro from sonata number 4 by Anna Bon, and I will follow that by playing the C major from sonata number 6. Let me play.
Thank you.
want to just do a little shout out here. You will hear Moore Martinez if you come to Oregon Bach Festival this summer. We actually, July 10th, I think the program features a cantata by Martinez. Is that right?
Yes.
So this is where I was actually writing a program that was, and I was researching. I was like, this is so cool. And I found all these different pieces by her. So Martinez was actually Spanish descent, but she was living in Austria, in Vienna at this time. And she was getting guidance from Libretto Metastasio, and because they were living very close to each other. And through these connections, she also got guidance from Haydn at this time. And these education resources, she obviously became a child prodigy and was garnering attention from the court and for singing, and she was also a great keyboard player. And her compositions are pretty idiomatic, which hopefully you will hear of the one I'm going to play. It fits the finger very well. I actually really like to play her pieces. It fits the finger very well, very comfortable. And at the same time, she's got this like amazing expression, and Charles Burney, 1772, praised her for the touching expression on her on top of like execution and her composition and all that. She was very influenced by C.P. Bach at this time, which is a Sturm und Drang style, which means kind of like really dramatic. And you will hear the way I'm going to play the sonata from the collection is I'm actually changing the keyboard a lot, trying to change the time of the different passages, even though it's not notated on the music, as a way of like increasing the dramatic tension. And this is something players at this time would know, oh, this is a different character we're bringing to a different kind of performance here. And she was also, Martinez was also performing in the salon at this time. And she was known for like playing forehand sonatas with Mozart. And here you go. This is her sonata from, G major sonata, I believe. And G major sonata for harpsichord. And the little handout I gave you, she also wrote keyboard sonatas, but we are not sure because it can be for forte piano, it can be for piano at this time already. This is 1760s, in the 1760s, but this one she actually dressed for the harpsichord. So this is the last piece I'm going to play. And, pay attention for the different contrasts I'm going to have here. Thank you. composers. And I just a little bit concluding thought here. I was a little bit not sure about, you know, the term women composer, because I think the moment when we put on women composer, there's a sense of otherness in there. Like, what is composer? Are we just assuming it's men at this time? Unfortunately, yes, most of the compositions we have from this time are by men. But then these pieces, if you don't tell me, I don't really notice, you know, this is by a female composer. But so I guess what I'm trying to say is I'm trying to celebrate these pieces, especially now it's coming to light in the last few years. And I will encourage people to program them, but I would be a little bit cautious of the narrative. You know, like I do see a lot of narrative like women composer. The moment we put on something like women composer, women scholarship, we actually are implying something different. But I hope my lecture recital shows that these compositions are actually really fantastic, really brilliant pieces that showcase just, you know, pieces we didn't know before, that were not written into the textbook, now were not programmed into the concert programs. But I think this is a good time for us to just all look into our programming a little bit, think about your next recital, what you're listening to. All right. Thank you.
Yeah.